First of all, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on which part of the world you are joining us from. It is my pleasure to moderate the second in a series of prestigious keynote talks from longstanding members and experts in the field of surgical robotics. Today, I am delighted to introduce Professor Rick Satava as our speaker for today. So Professor Rick Satava is Emeritus Professor of Surgery at the University of Washington Medical Center in Seattle, and an accomplished clinician, both as a civilian and as a member of the armed forces, which he was part of for over 23 years. After completing his medical training in Johns Hopkins and through a surgical residency in the Mayo Clinic, Rick has accrued innumerable accolades with over 20 years of military surgery experience, where he has been an active flight surgeon, a hospital commander during Operation Desert Storm, and a professor of surgery in the Army Medical Corps at Walter Reed Army Medical Center. He also has a prolific research career with hundreds of publications and a countless number of awards and editorial positions to his name. Rick has influenced American policy in his role on the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, Policy Committee on Health, Food and Safety, and championed the adoption of technology in surgery, notably as one of the lead surgeons in the team that worked on what eventually became the Da Vinci robotic system. Today, he will be sharing his precious insights on advanced surgical robotic technologies, and I'm very much looking forward to his talk, which will be followed by what I hope will be a thriving Q&A session. As context, the Q&A session will happen through the chat at the bottom of your screen. So please, as questions arise, feel free to write them down or annotate them in the chat so that I can put these to Rick on completion of his talk. Now, without further ado, I'll hand over to Rick for his presentation. Thank you, Rick.
Well, thank you very much. Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes,
are you able? Pardon me?
We are, yes.
Okay, fine. Well, thank you once again for the opportunity to present at this, the 13th annual Hamlyn Symposium on Medical Robotics. And thank you not only to you, Federico, but to the members of your staff, to the enormous amount of work I know that goes into putting together such a conference. Without further ado, I will move forward. There is a lot happening in the future. This is my disclosure slide, which is required from everyone. This is about disruptive visions, changing the way the future will be. Yogi Berra, a baseball player, said the future is not what it used to be. What that means, we have to relook at what the future will look like from basic principles. The pioneer for something like this would be Henry Ford. When he asked people what they wanted, they said they wanted a faster horse, meaning I want what I have today, I just want it better. And disruptive technology is one that will go ahead and completely revolutionize a particular field. This happened back in the 1850s, but it took multiple different technologies in order to be able to have the surgery that we know today. Here are the different technologies that were required that over a 40-year period of time were actually able to put together with the modern age of surgery. We have the same opportunity now. We are in a renaissance, if you will. This is the information age, and these are the technologies that we have available that are emerging. And a matter of integrating them is going to give us the most important and the best opportunities for futures in surgery. We've already got flexible endoscopy and robotic surgery, but there are many other areas that we could add to our robotic surgery to dramatically improve them and get to the place where we can make things that we thought previously were impossible. So this is the information age. And the postulate is that the new technologies that are emerging from the information age discoveries are driving our basic approach to all areas of healthcare. Within surgery, this is the progress that we have made because of the information age technologies. All the way from open surgery, And you'll notice that when endoluminal surgery began in the 70s, it was only about 30 years before we had robotic surgery as well. And that's because there was a unique opportunity with the robots. If you think about it, the first time I did robotic surgery, I did not see my patient, nor did I touch them. I looked at a monitor, which was the information representation of the patient. And when I moved my hands on the input devices, they made the instruments move. So in essence, the computer interface between me and the patient gave us the opportunity to do things that we were not able to do, such as remote surgery, data fusion and preoperative planning and surgical rehearsal. And you could even, if you will, practice before surgery with simulation and training. So this gave us the opportunity to view the robot not as a machine, but as an information system. And when you do, you can now integrate robotics into the new technologies that are moving forward. For example, we built a robotic cell in which we had an operation in which there were no patients and no people in the operating room other than the patient. For example, the surgeon would ask for a gauze. The robotic arm would reach in the supply cabinet and provide it for them. If the surgeon needed a change in instrument, he would say, "Surgeon, scalpel for the right hand." It would remove the grasper, replace it with the scalpel, and return the grasper to the tool changer. So we now have the opportunity for, and has been going on in industry for decades, the opportunity to be able to integrate multiple robots into a single opportunity. So the question then became immediately, can we do telesurgery, and how far and how long will it take until we can do it in someplace like their home? Tongue in cheek, of course. The question to that was that we can do it, but the problem is that we have a latency issue. Today, because of COVID and everything, finally telemedicine is becoming mainstream, and it's going to give this the new hybrid approach to healthcare. However, at the end of last year, the number of robotic surgical procedures had increased to 7.5 million cases over the interval, but none of them were telesurgery, and only a total of 35 had been performed, with the last one being in 2007, the main problem being latency. And if we look at the chart here, this is some of the data. It's a composite of many different research projects that we're going and can add as a guide on the importance of latency. If there's no latency, there's nothing that you need to compensate. At 50 milliseconds of latency, you don't really perceive it, but you automatically and subconsciously are able to compensate. But by 100 milliseconds, you know something's wrong, but you're able to compensate without paying much attention to it. At 150 milliseconds, you know that there's a delay. You have to take actions like move and wait in order to successfully complete it. And it may impact slightly upon the number of errors that you do. At 150 milliseconds, there's no question that you know about the delay. And attempts at various methods are mostly successful. By the time you hit 300 milliseconds, it's critical. You have multiple errors, some of them critical errors, and the surgeon is often frustrated and most often not successful. So improvement, if you will, in communication systems will allow us to move into the next generation, which would be telesurgery. So this depends upon a communication system. And nowadays, that communication system is becoming an ecosystem. We have multiple smart devices out there that are trying to input onto the communication system. And the output that they desire is once again multiple, whether they be smartphones, watches, automobiles, buses, and even the surgical telesurgery, if you will. There are many things that are important about the new communication system. It depends upon devices at either end. It doesn't help if you've got one telephone on either end, only two people can talk to themselves. So we're now in this multiple systems. There is a healthcare Internet of Things. It is massive and it's growing, whether it be your Fitbit or the different devices and instruments that are in the hospital. One of the key problems that we have is it needs a human interface technology that's intuitive, that makes it easy to use these instruments. And I'll talk about that later. Telemedicine, meaning consultations and in the future telesurgery, will need reimbursement. This is a barrier, and we have very few approval for telemedicine technologies. And any new technology that is becoming successful in terms from financial return on investment needs a large number of inputs and outputs, if you will. And we need yet to determine what the impact of big data, edge computing, and supercomputing are, and I will be mentioning these shortly. Here we are with the new generation of communication technologies, which is critical to advancing. And I will explain in depth why these are important. For example, we are using the fourth generation now, and we're beginning to connect more and more devices and communication networks. And we have digital technologies that are critical to robotics, artificial intelligence, the Internet of Other Things, big data, the robots themselves, and even things such as automobiles. All will become integrated and are becoming integrated, but the bandwidth is still a limiting issue. However, the result is going to be, as our communications increase, more digital technologies are going to be included, causing each addition of technology to the ecosystem stimulates the need for a larger bandwidth and lower latency. And with each increase that we have in bandwidth and latency, we will have an opportunity for new technologies to join. And so we're going to end up with an exponential upward spiral of growth in the technologies, including the robotic capabilities. Currently, we are in the fourth generation, and our bandwidth is limited to 5 to 200 megahertz. The speed is between 10 and 50 megabits per second, giving us a latency of 50 to 60 milliseconds, which limits the capabilities for remote consultation and surgery. However, the new generation that's being implemented now over the next decade, the fifth generation has a capability of somewhere between 1 and 24 gigahertz, giving us a speed that is 1,000 times faster than what we have available today and reduces our latency down to between 1 and 10 milliseconds, depending upon the application. The next generation, which is in the laboratory, is measuring out in the terahertz level in terms of the amount of information that can be pushed through in a second, and the speed. The speed is in terabits per second. This results in a latency of 1 to 10 microseconds, instantaneous, below our level of perception. So these are the technologies that are going to enable, if you will, the integration of robotics into the new healthcare system, as well as society in general. Other critical technologies that I believe are key to the success of robotics is going to be the Internet of Things. Robots are going to be connected as many other medical devices that are out there. Artificial intelligence, which I'll touch on momentarily, is what makes everything smart and allows us to exponentially improve the capabilities of our robotic systems and enhance the capabilities of the surgeon. Big data, computational analytics will provide the repositories and the data that we need in order to improve the capabilities of our robotics. And a new concept of edge computing. Right now, things like big data and supercomputers are in the cloud. Massive storage. They're at a central location, usually far away from a hospital where they're needed. In the future, edge computing is going to be moving them to the local entities so that you will literally have all the supercomputing power that you would need, all the data that you could possibly need will be local, and therefore you will have access to that. You won't have to build it into your robot, but simply be able to access it. For example, artificial intelligence now has become ubiquitous. They are referred to as our smart devices, and in hospitals alone, last year, there were between 10 and 15 million medical devices connected to the Internet of Things. It is now becoming part of that ecosystem. And they are dependent upon things that are not locally available, such as supercomputing, big data, repositories, wearables, people walking around with their smartphones or their Fitbits. Those are not normally in the hospital. They don't have availability, but with edge computing, it will make it possible to have all these supporting structures. And here is a list, I'm not going through them, of the different aspects that already have technologies that are beginning to emerge because of the capability of the internet as a whole. Administration, electronic medical records, logistics, medical support systems like lab, pharmacy, radiology, clinical medicine, surgical procedures will in the future expand, and of course, education and training. We have evidence of the importance of artificial intelligence on each of these particular fields. To give you an example, what it means is that when the COVID-19 broke out in Wuhan, China, they had a total of 70,000 beds with 14 medical centers. Within 24 hours of declaring the emergency, they had installed 4,000 new beds in what are called shelter hospitals for, in essence, triaging the cases to determine which ones can be handled locally and which ones need to be referred forward. It took them just over 24 hours to establish three of these in auditoriums or in stadiums. And they were connected directly to all the rest of the medical systems in which the 5G had been installed within that 24-hour period. It gave them both an intranet so they could communicate with all the different areas within their hospital, as well as internet, allowing them to go back to the medical centers and the new cabin hospitals that were being built, which were hospitals that had been, in essence, pre-positioned in containers, shipping containers, but they were departments, medical departments such as laboratory, radiology, intensive care units, operating room. And it was simply a matter that within a week, they were able to install another 13,000 beds by integrating everything together and just bringing the modules and connecting them. And once again, the 5G wireless high bandwidth provided them with the capabilities to integrate the entire system. I want to move to a separate set of principles that are very, very important in my mind. When we're talking about dealing in healthcare, we're talking about living systems. And because of that, we have to integrate them. This is a human interface technology issue. Some of the problems that we have are the biological principles that underline humans. That is that we do not work as rapidly as a mechanical system would. And for example, here are the millisecond delays that we have when we're talking about how quickly that we are able to react. So the fundamental principles here is that the systems that are being built to support us today, supercomputers, communications, artificial intelligence, work faster than the humans. And we need to be able to be certain that we build systems that will take that into account. The fundamental issue with humans are, as we do this integration with our new technologies and our robotics, they have capabilities that are beyond our capabilities. And we need to make a match, this human interface technology match. And right now, with the new 5Gs coming on, they only deal with physics and engineering, but we have the limitations, if you will, of the human performance. Some important issues that have been illustrated in the past are attention. everybody talks about multitasking, but quite frankly, the data shows that errors begin to increase when you try to do more than two cognitive tasks at a time. This is evidenced by the fact that in 2019 in the United States alone, there were 11,000 pedestrian texting deaths. People thought that they could be on their cell phone and ignore what was going around them, and it dramatically increased the number of deaths. Cognitive tasks require our full attention. And if you are overloading your system with situational awareness, automatic tasks, that doesn't leave much room in your brain to think about things cognitively. Another area that is still under investigation and is going to be very difficult within healthcare, it's the reverse. Human capabilities for touch and haptics and so forth are enormous. We have 23 different types of sensors histologically identified that go at 1 kilohertz per second, meaning that 1,000 times per second, each one of these 23 different sensors are sending information back to the brain. And on top of that, in one hand alone, you've got over 4,000 millimeters of these deposits of your sensors. So the issue is that we're talking about 10 to the 15th computations that need to be done in order to provide a haptics device that will be as sensitive for the human as enough of a fidelity that you can do it as if you were using your own hands. I'm not going to address the issues of humanoid robots, but I just wanted to show you what I think was a New Year's card I got from Boston Dynamics as to where they are now with their humanoid robots. For those of you who already have seen this, I apologize. And so this is not only the capability of a single robot, but this robot is communicating with others. It's part of the interest that I've been trying to emphasize. On the internet, because it goes on for another few moments. But I wanted to, this is a robotic cell. Robots talking with each other and being able to perform a dance. All right, so what is this all about? Well, the information age is not the future. It's here, it's the present, and there's something else out there. This is a completely different topic area than what we were just discussing. And so the question then becomes, where is the future? Well, the future now is the age of information and energy. And it was because of Nobel laureate Richard Feynman that disrupted the science, taking, if you will, the science now to a new level, but a level at the bottom, as he said. There's plenty of room at the bottom, probably the most important lecture given in science this past century. The rules of physics were changing as you get down to the atomic level and the molecular level. He redefined the future of science. Technology is now available to work at the molecular level. During this lecture, he defined quantum mechanics, nanotechnology, and predicted in the near future that the structure of DNA would be discovered because of the capabilities of the new devices that they were using at this level. So the fundamental change that we see is from the industrial age to the information age, from tissues and instruments, tangible and physical structures, to information and energy, which are not truly tangible and not visible, if you will. We see their functional effects. So it's no longer about objects and atoms, it's about bits and bytes. the future direction of surgery now, because of the progress we've made to date, is going to be non-invasive. And we've noticed that in 2015, we began seeing instruments that are using directed energy. Each niche is going to continue, and the proportions will change depending upon the needs. So we need to rethink healthcare. It's the flow of information and energy that's going to guide the future of medicine. Energy, as most of you engineers know better than I, is the electromagnetic spectrum. And the problem that I view is that we, meaning healthcare, has been ignoring this. We are using only a tiny proportion of the electromagnetic spectrum to accomplish things. With AI, we now have intelligent instruments, and from Blake Hannaford's lab back in 2009, developed a grasper that was intelligent. And it had a light-emitting diode like we have in pulse oximeters. This instrument was able to give you, with five different sensors, not only pressure, stiction, and a number of the mechanical data, but also those which came with pulse oximeters, such as blood flow and so forth. So we now have the capabilities to begin integrating, using things such as MEMS technology, more intelligence into our instruments. But we need the AI that we can access through the internet to be able to take advantage of these new ones. So it's all about exploiting the energy spectrum and the information space. We now have built new instruments as the cornerstone of systems integration, if you will, that performs both diagnosis and therapy in real time at the point of care, in handheld portable instruments with low power. They could be autonomous for closed loop feedback, and eventually some may become home-based consumer products. The change is that it's all about interacting at a different scale. Da Vinci said, man is the measure of all things. That meant that we can compare the real world with data about ourselves. And that's the scale we would work at. But now that we have instruments, telescopes, microscopes, CT scans, and so forth, we now have the capability to go down to where the real disease occurs, which is at the cellular level. And you'll see the different scales that we have capability of these instruments at. We can see at microns and nanometers. We can work at microseconds and femtoseconds and with a very low amount of power and so forth. So we can, at this point in time, are beginning to learn how to control molecules and electrons using photons and others. I'm sure most of you are well aware of molecular imaging for diagnosis, biosurgery, as some people are calling it. A light photonics goes to a tissue sample. Some of it's reflected, some of it's resorbed. The difference between the amount that goes in of energy and the amount that is sensed on your detector gives you, to the right, the signature of specific molecules. So we now have the capability to instantaneously make diagnosis at the molecular level. For example, distinguishing between normal cells and cancer cells so that you can know exactly what to do. So it's all about these intelligent systems with energy input and cyclically doing the diagnosis, taking that diagnosis and instantly turning on the therapeutics. Information controls the energy. If we have a closed loop feedback of 50 milliseconds, which is a long period of time, a surgeon can perform in 1 second, 50 complete procedures. In a minute, 1,200 complete diagnostic and therapeutic procedures, and in 10 minutes, 12,000, et cetera. But this is at the cellular level. So we have the capabilities, the instruments to be able to do that, and the artificial intelligence to do that. So an example is, here is from the University of Washington Ultrasound Lab, Larry Crum, developed a point of care non-invasive therapy called high intensity focused ultrasound, in which the central Doppler allows you to do the diagnosis in real time and you can turn on the high intensity focus ultrasound, which circumscribes the device. The military was interested in this, and so they wondered whether or not we could use this concept to stop internal exsanguinating hemorrhage in wounded soldiers. This pink model will show you the internal iliac artery. The Doppler ultrasound shows you that it has just lacerated the internal iliac artery. This pig will be dead in 10 minutes. However, with this device, now that they know precisely where it is and it's co-located, they turned on the high intensity focused ultrasound, which electrocoagulates, if you will, the proteins and stops and closes, seals off the vessel, and non-invasively is able to stop the bleeding. This is just one example of where we're beginning to use energy in non-invasive surgery. At the University of Tennessee, neurosurgeons have been using this. They found the wavelength of light that penetrates through the skull. And together with molecular markers for cancers such as astrocytomas and glioblastoma multiforme, they inject an IV of the marker for the cancer. And then 20 minutes later, they are able to apply the photonics at a specific spectrum, and that spectrum activates the molecules to induce apoptosis and kill only the cancer cells. So this is the threshold that we are beginning to reach at this time. And I do believe that it imparts the future as directed energy for diagnosis and therapy, which has been described as DDAT, just as laser stands for light amplification and so forth. So what is radically new? There are other non-technologies. I would like to emphasize that there is a dependence upon robotics for nearly every one of the technologies that I've been showing you, because it enhances human precision to a point that they can actually use the directed energy at the cellular and molecular level. Incidentally, I am not aware of any directed energy weapons that are being looked at and integrating into robotic systems. So 3D printed organs in vivo, if you will, molecular markers that I mentioned, nanotechnology, suspended animation instead of anesthesia, a number of technologies that are out there. I am going to go ahead and rapidly go through some potential other areas that you might want to look into. Replacing human body parts we have, and you know about robotic prostheses and the brain-machine interface that is now being employed in clinical research for soldiers who have had upper arm amputations. 3D printing is another area for regenerative medicine and tissue engineering. There is Tony Atala back in 1999 giving a TED lecture at which during the time he gave the lecture, he was actually printing a porcine kidney. And at the end, as you see in the lower corner, he showed a completed kidney that had been printed. As a matter of fact, every known tissue and organ in the human body except for the brain. I just ran across the other day a robotic system. This is at the end of a endoscope. They have a 3D printer, bioprinter, that can go down into the stomach and print living cells over an ulcer to heal it rather than having to give them medications. And that's an instantaneous procedure that occurs. Other things that have happened because of 3D printing, as you can see, we can do things such as bone replacement, cartilage replacement, we can grow skin, and we can even put together both mechanical and living systems together, hybrid tissue and electronics. And another one that's going to be really important in the future is microorgans or organs on a chip, taking a biopsy of a patient, say their liver or their kidney or whatever, and you put them in a well, and then you can test their own tissue against, say, the antibiotics, the chemotherapeutic agent, or whatever. this is going to require the robotics of 3D printing. And you can even do, as Don Inberg has demonstrated, that you can put a body on a chip, and each of the wells is a different organ system. And you can, at this time in research, investigate what happens when a particular toxic agent or antibiotic or chemotherapeutic agent is placed into the body, how the different organs will be reacting on a specific patient. If you print an organ by using the patient's own cells, it will not be rejected, which is the number one problem that we have today in transplantation. So there's a very, very promising future with various things that are going to be based upon and supported by robotics. Most things can be printed. I'm sorry, that one's confidential. That's a classified project that we did. But the hypothesis-driven scientific method needs to be used in order to be able to validate and make sure that what we want to do is safe. No matter how certain we are that what we built is going to be safe, it seems that there's always some unintended consequence that we have. Experience is the name that everyone gives to their mistakes. But Michelangelo had it right. The only thing more dangerous than trying too hard and failing is not trying hard enough but succeeding. So I would like to thank you for the opportunity to provide this lecture. And I will end with a question that perhaps some of your participants here can answer. And that question is, do robots dream? Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Thank you, Rick. This was an absolutely astonishing overview of past, present, and future of surgical robotics. And I would encourage our audience to engage with us now with questions. As I mentioned in the chat, you can ask these questions on the chat box or in the Q&A box, and either during the session today or even offline, we'll endeavor to reply to these. And as the audience thinks and writes, I had a few questions that popped up during your presentation, but the most important one, which I think you would be uniquely placed to answer, has to do with the fact that I've been in surgery and technology for quite a while now, and it is absolutely the case that adoption is low. And I think in surgery, we tend to learn from our mistakes slower than in other fields. So if I, you know, the big comparison is, you know, if you think about aviation, you know, black box, there is no stigma associated to failure or error, especially human error. And so you learn from that and you make sure it doesn't happen again. I think in surgery, it's a little bit more guarded, and there is a little bit more stigma associated with it. And so there is the secrecy of surgery and the difficulty in then learning from those mistakes. So my question was, is it different when you are a military clinician and are working within a completely different setup with a very different set of patients? So is it easier? Is it more streamlined? Is it more transparent because of the high pressure environment you are working in?
Well, thank you for the question. That's one that always comes up. I think there are a number of factors currently going on, including the pressure put on by the pandemic, because many of the delays in getting new technologies forward is trying to determine through validation and clinical trials that this particular device or medication is safe. And you have seen that what was normally a laborious process of a minimum of 7 to 10 years, usually 15 years to develop a new vaccine, now was done within a month, less than a year, and they had emergency one. So if the need is there, we will find out that the bureaucracy will respond. The big question is when the pandemic is over and these urgent needs are gone back to casual, the question will be, will these bureaucratic procedures learn from what we had during the pandemic, or will they end up going back to the previous way that we went? So that is one of the issues that I think that is going to be important in terms of advancing forward. The second issue is that, as I mentioned, trying to describe the ecosystem, when you have multiple things working together, they reinforce one another, and rather than linearly increasing, they exponentially increase. And so we will see dramatic improvements, if you will, as robotics begins integrating and collaborating through the network with things such as making AI available instantaneously with edge computing, supercomputers to do the computing and the analytics and so forth. So we will see a compression of time in my mind. And particularly as we start moving down to on a lower scale at the molecular level where so much of the work is being done. The number one journal in the United States, in the world today is Cell, about molecular biology.
Yeah.
And so the enormous amount of work doing at that particular level that surgeons at this point in time have not engaged in. If we start moving in that direction, we will see, particularly by using energy that is what we need in order to manipulate at that level, that we will have an increase, if you will, in the opportunities. I'd like to close the answer with, you notice the video of the robotic dancing. That is the issue of integrating robotic cells. At the moment, the entire medical robotics community is focused on a robot, a soft robot, a flexible robot, this kind of robot. They're ignoring the capabilities that are out there. And I am imploring that they look at the other things that I've mentioned in the lecture and see how they can enhance what they're doing within the robotic area. Thank you for the question.
Nick, following on from this, so you were right there when, what is it, the 90s, yeah, the ISS and the Da Vinci was launched and a few other robots like Robodoc and so on. And so through the early 2000s, you had this big renaissance of robotic technology was the best thing since sliced bread. And then there was this sort of anticlimactic phase in the late 2000s and early 2010s, right, where actually many clinicians got disarmed with robotics because it didn't quite deliver on the promise. And now, yeah, in 2021, 2020, the last 5 years, let's say, is back sort of second renaissance. So is it cyclical, or from where you sit and with the experience you have had, is this the one, is this the wave we ride all the way to widespread adoption? So is surgical technology still gonna, you know, is there gonna be another trough?
I think that there are two things that can accelerate this. Today we have the concept of the hype cycle, Gardner's hype cycle, where a new technology comes in, everybody gets excited before the technology is really ready. And then there becomes a time when they try to implement it, the phase of disillusion. And then you have a very slow adoption as the scientific method takes over and you validate and prove these things. I think this can be enhanced dramatically in two ways. One, the use of simulation. Right now, clinical trials get enough data to determine one way or another. Simulation is getting nearly good enough to be able to determine what the most likely outcome will be and how safe it will be. So I think we can accelerate what we're doing by adding simulation into the process and then follow that up with lesser amounts of clinical trials that will be necessary to prove that not only the device is safety, but the simulation actually predicts that it will be safe. Depending upon the technology right now, simulation is somewhere between 85 and 90% accurate in their predictions. So that will save us a significant amount. That is what was done with the development of vaccines for COVID.
And I think, go ahead. It's this clinical pull. I think, you know, there was this absolutely unprecedented global desire and need for something to happen quicker, you know, and humanity stepped up. And actually every single bit of red tape we have encountered over decades basically was pushed aside on the MHRA side and on FDA and so on. I was surprised you actually mentioned HIFU, which is a technology which was absolutely up and coming and very hot topic when in the late 90s, I started to dabble with this sort of surgical technology and so on. And of course, you know, 20 odd years down the line, it's still not quite in the big leagues, right? And it's unclear to me what exactly happened, because that was very promising then. The basic technology was understood back then, but I guess something was missing.
Two answers. The first is there weren't enough champions. All right. You have to have people that believe in this and will do the trials that will be accepted by the community as a whole. The second is that it is very successful. You just don't know about it. It's not in an area that you are particularly working at. It was not successful in the area of prostate simply because we didn't have a high fidelity ultrasound to guide it. But in the future, we would anticipate that it would come back. There are numerous unsuccessful, if you will, uses of the ultrasound. They didn't tolerate failure and didn't persist. I had 158 programs when I was funding research from the government through DARPA. Of the 158 programs, not a single one got it right the first time.
100%.
You must persist. You can't invent something brand new to discover it and expect that the first time it will work 100%. And that's through the expectation of the medical community. So those are some factors that I think that are working against us at this point in time.
You see, the thing is, I don't know how it is in the US, but I think with government priorities and public acceptance and public priorities, you change the way that you look at where your strategic research funding should go. And that tends to have a much smaller horizon than it actually takes to get some of these technologies from bench to bedside. And so I think that also makes a big difference, right? So at this very moment, for example, we're going through a real hype in funding on robotics and healthcare, right? But we went through quite a tough time in the United Kingdom where the amount of funding available for this region had reduced. So I don't know how we could lobby government and funders to give this sort of longer term horizons for the higher risk things that would require many failures before big substantive improvements are made or outcomes are achieved. Is it the same in the US?
You are 100% correct on this. And this is the political aspect of healthcare. You've seen the disaster that happened here in the United States with our former president, who denied that COVID was a pandemic and did nothing, including not providing funding for research, which came out of funding initially by the commercial sector, but it did not even acknowledge it. Politics and financing is an important part of this. So we have, at least in the United States, and I'm sure other countries around the world, lobbyists that are out there that are advocating for funding. Unfortunately, the budget's a zero-sum game. And so we're competing against other things, including desire to make profit. And so until we can get over the political aspect of it, we're going to have to fight it. I would like you to recognize that when flexible endoscopy began, when laparoscopic surgery began, when robotic surgery began, it was a minimum of 5 to 10 years before we were able to get it out because of resistance within the medical community to provide the evidence that it was safe. I hope that in the future, by the introduction of simulation in this approval process, will help decrease the amount of time required for that.
Absolutely. We also have a question from Ashwin from the audience, who is in regenerative medicine at UCL. And he says, thank you for the session, truly informative. Generally asking, for robotic surgery, which skills will be needed in the surgical team alongside the surgeons and surgical technologists? So are there other specialties that you think will become increasingly more important alongside obviously the two key players, which are surgeons and surgical technologists?
I think the most important answer to that is it depends upon how well designed the device that the surgeon will be using, whether it be simple like a new kind of scalpel, or it be very complicated like a robotic system. If it is intuitive, if it has a great human interface technology, let me give you a quick example on why I think robotic surgery was able to be commercialized in 7 to 10 years instead of the usual 15. When we were building the first surgical robot upon which the Da Vinci evolved, we brought medical students in to test it. One of them, while we were lecturing about it, saw the console sitting in the corner, sat down and started picking up rings and putting them on pegs. One of them fell out of the reach of the robotic system. So he looked down underneath and tried to find the ring. The ring wasn't there because the arms were in the other room. And we knew at that moment that at least that particular version of the robot had gotten an excellent human interface technology. No one had to tell them what to do. You sit down and you're able to go and understand what needs to be done. Yes, there'll be some training initially on how the device works. But we knew that once you did that, this was as intuitive as using your own hands. That's the kind of device interaction that we need with the new types of devices that are coming forward. Many of them are not intuitive how you use them. You need an engineer there to tell you.
And after many years and having seen technologies at every stage of development, it is true that this is the one absolute competitive advantage the intuitive platform continues to have. As the name says, intuitive indeed, right? It really is one of the most natural interfaces that I have actually interacted with. Thank you. We have a few minutes more, and if there are no questions, I have a couple more, which are slightly more relevant to your earlier conversation, because you did mention about speed, right? And it's absolutely true, having just upgraded my phone to 5G, that the bandwidth that is available today dwarfs what you could even imagine downloading onto a portable device 5 years ago, and the trend is exponential. Now, the question though I have, which relates to surgery and this idea, which is particularly pertinent in the military context, which is telemedicine, right? Will we ever be able to have the guarantee that the remote communication at incredibly high frequency will not interrupt and thus leave a surgeon stranded on one side with the patient bleeding on the other side, right? And it is something I actually pondered upon for a long time, because no matter what, that is the one single point of failure, which I am not sure how you would be able to mitigate if the system went down.
Very quickly, what is the issue is bandwidth. And now with the amazing amount of increase in bandwidth, we can implement software strategies, such as duplication of data moving forward, error checking, if you will. They have tested out systems with the 5G, and the 5G system now has the capability with things like redundancy, error checking, and so forth, to have a 6-9 capabilities. That means that it is 99.999 reliable, six orders of magnitude of reliability. That's once in 10,000 times they may drop one or two bits. That's extraordinary. We go to the next generation, which is sixth generation, now we're working at terahertz levels. It's going to be even more reliable than what we have. Addition to that is the question of security. And with the new, error checking system that we have that goes out to 128 bits of error checking, I'm blanking on the name of it, that will give us a security that at least for the next decade or two, will be 100% secure. And the problem is that it's rolling it out and getting it, that error checking capability or that security preventing capability within the systems.
So, and this I promise is my last question since I pretty much monopolized the conversation. Based on the bandwidth advantage, we also have the issue of enormous amount of data being made available and easily transferable. And of course, researchers like me and clinical technologists like you tend to always be optimistic about the uses that this data can have for patients and for healthcare. However, there is this growing worry, yeah, especially in the lay community, about the nefarious possibilities that you could have when this enormous amount of data, which could include personal information or rather unique aspects of your biological data, available for not such positive purposes. So, and it is more of a curiosity about your position. Do you feel that this is a real problem, or do you feel that it is simply a function of people being worried about what they don't know?
I think at the moment, there may be a relatively minor problem here that will be solvable. You have to identify the problem before you can solve it. And so we, for example, are now looking at bias in the data that's collected. There's nothing wrong with the repositories that we have, but it's the data that is put in the repository that's the problem. So if you have methodologies out there, and these are based upon human failings, that allows you to put equitable data in, then you'll be able to solve that problem. The other question that is being addressed in AI now that is very important is explainable technology. Right now, when we send information into an AI system, we get an answer, but we have no idea how that answer was arrived at. So the question is, can we now build algorithms that will explain what they did in order to reach a particular conclusion? So I think these two areas of making equitable types of data that's put into the repositories, and second of all, the ability to understand how the algorithms reach that conclusion, those are two areas that I think that are going to improve our data, if you will.
Thank you very much. We're out of time, but I would like to thank you on behalf of the audience for taking the time to give us a wonderful presentation. And I also wanted to thank the team behind the scenes that makes all of this possible. A few reminders for our audience, which are that obviously we have a series of events like these, and you can always access www.hamlynsymposium.org to see what comes next. We had our first workshop last week, which was very well received, and we have a battery of workshops and activities planned for the next couple of months. Just a reminder, there's also an open call for special issue papers in TMRB and a poster competition for the younger audience. So please encourage your teams or yourselves to get involved with the activities of the symposium. With that, I'd like to thank Rick again and thank the audience, and I will see you at the next one. Thank you. Thank you very much.
And thank you for continuing the Hamlyn Symposium.
My pleasure. Okay. Absolute privilege. Thank you. Bye-bye.